Hello, everyone. Thanks, Jake. Glad everyone is here this morning. I'm glad nobody blew away last night. And so, we were watching the radar. It's always fun. It's like the thing in Iowa to do is just gather around and watch the radar. What's going to happen? Let's roll the dice. It was good. We were glad you were here. Just a couple of announcements this morning. If you're a first-time guest with us, if you could do me a favor, in the chair in front of you, there should be a card that says Connect Card. And it's just our way to get some information about you so we can get you some information about our church. And that way we can get you information about who we are, what things we do, get you plugged in with our ministries here at Whiting Christian Church. Another announcement, the only other announcement I have, we'll wait until next week to pile on more and more announcements. I was like, let's just have 1 week. Tonight is our family meeting at 6 o'clock. We have Staley's Catering, and so that'll be tonight. And with that, if we could ask for a little bit of help after service today, if we could get some people to come with us over to the gym and get tables set up, that would be greatly appreciated. And we'll remind you at the end of service as well. But I just want to throw it out there. If you could hang around for 5-10 minutes and just help us get tables set up so we can get them decorated and ready for tonight. And my wife is signaling to me that I also need to mention VBS. I'm so bad at reading lips, so I'm just like, what are you saying? It's like we're doing charades as I'm trying to do announcements. Yes, VBS, I'll mention that. I don't have a slide for that in here right now. VBS is coming up. Decorating starts Wednesdays in May from 4:30 to 6:30. Is that correct, Sam? Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's correct. 4:30 to 6 Thursday, Wednesday nights, we do decorating. You do not have to be creative to be able to help in the decorating process. We do take non-creative types. I'm one of those people, and I get to help. So you're more than welcome to come help. Get ready for VBS. And then VBS registration is open. So we have cards out here for you if you want to grab one of those. You can also go to our website, and it's right there in the front. You can find how to register kids for VBS for this summer, which will be the beginning of June. And so we're excited. There's still signups out there as well. So we are looking forward to all of that. But today is Family Sunday. We're excited to see all the families with us, all the kiddos in service. Let me go ahead and I will pray, and then we will invite some kiddos up to lead us in our first song this morning. But let me go ahead and start us with prayer. Dear God, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for this time. We have survived Easter. Your son survived Easter. He is alive. He is out of the tomb. And we are excited to keep going, to keep celebrating you, God, what you are doing here in Whiting, what you are doing around Whiting, in our country and around everywhere. And so we are looking forward to continuing to see what you are doing and how we can partner with you in that. But for now, let us lift up a word of praise to you, God, because you are good. And let us lift our voices to you, God. It's in your son's name that we pray. Amen. Okay. If I could get my amazing kiddo leaders to come up on stage and lead us in our first song. Come on up. Are you going to join this? Yeah, come on, come on, come on. You going to join Remy? Yeah, buddy. Come on up.
Place to hide this weary soul, this vagabond.
Whoa, here we go. Take two. Just kidding. Awesome. Hey, if you guys can take a seat. If this is your first time with us on a family Sunday, it's been a while since I've explained why we do this. Number one, and primarily number one, we are a body, we are a family as a church. And it is good for us to do things intergenerationally. It is good for us to bring our families together and worship our God together because we are a family. And so that's one of the reasons why we have these family Sundays, and we want the kiddos to feel a part of it. We want them to feel like they matter here on a Sunday morning, and so that's why we start with this kids song, is to show them, hey, we love what you guys are doing. We love what you guys do in Children's Church during the rest of the month. We want to celebrate with you. We want to worship with you, and so we appreciate that. These family Sundays are also so that we can get some of our children's volunteers a break. They work really hard in the children's area, and it's nice to be able to get them in service and not have to worry about that for one Sunday a month. And so that's another reason why we do this. And so I just want to throw it out there. You know, as we sing these kids' songs, it might feel silly to do these motions and to get into these songs in the way that we do. But man, it's setting such an amazing example for the kiddos that are in the room with us to show them, you know, yes, it is great to sing loud to our God and to be able to do motions and, you know, David dance before the Lord. It is okay to move about in service. And so I just want to start with that and remind this is why we have Family Sundays. But before I go into my message, will you just pray with me again real quick? Dear God, I thank you again for today that we can be here and worship as families. And I thank you for those kiddos that bring a life into our church. And yes, we want to celebrate them and their passion and their faith for you and their willingness to demonstrate their own worship for us adults. And we, I pray that we can give them back that example of what it looks like to follow you, God, and that as a whole, as a family, that we can grow closer to you, God. It's in your son's name that I pray. Amen. So today we start a new sermon series, and here's where this idea for this new series came from. We're calling it Made New. There are so many times with sermons where I only get to touch on a subject. You know, maybe I get to touch briefly on prayer or worship or discipleship or so many other different topics that we talk about on a Sunday morning. But part of the struggle I have with this is that there's only so much that you can talk about in a single message, right? I can't cover prayer as a whole in a single message. I can't cover discipleship as a whole in a single message. And so, you know, sometimes I'm like, hey, let's talk about it in a more general blown up view and we're going to graze the top. Or it's like, hey, let's look at a very focused part of this big thing. And I just always come back to, man, it would be so great to be able to walk away from a message series and be like, yeah, I think I covered everything on that topic that I wanted to be able to cover. And so that was the mindset back in October when I was working on message series for this year. What should we do? What should it look like? What would be good? And I was like, you know what? I want to do that. I want to take a topic and I want to pound it hard and feel like, man, we've covered this now. We've talked about this. This was good. There was nothing left unsaid. And so brace yourself. For the next 8 weeks, okay? I know some of you are going to be like, oh, yeah, this is a terrible idea. Bear with me. For the next 8 weeks, we're going to talk about baptism. For the next 8 weeks, we're going to talk about baptism. I also, you know, I want to throw out there that when I planned this series in October, again, okay, October, I didn't know that we would start our year with 9 baptisms already. Yes, absolutely worth celebrating. And so I was like, man, this would be a great opportunity to get some people who are on the fence into the water. And man, we've already got 9 people in there. So let's just keep going. We're gonna hope that even more want to get baptized by the end of this series and that we can finish our year with a record for our church for baptisms. The goal is by the time this 8 weeks are up, that we have a well-rounded understanding of exactly what baptism is and why it matters in our faith life. And I have confidence that this is going to be a great 8 weeks, so let's get rolling week number one. So, if I showed you an image, if I showed you this, this image, it's kind of hard to see, but do you guys remember this? Right? Does anybody remember this? Can you see it, Matt? Can you see it back there, Matt? Okay, perfect. Yeah, MapQuest. Does anyone remember MapQuest? Yeah, good old MapQuest. You know, I got thinking about MapQuest, and I was like, we're in the age of reality TV shows. We need a reality TV show where they take this young Gen Z group, and hey, you get nothing but MapQuest in this like amazing race style event, get from one side of the US to the other. And then to make it even better, you only get dial-up internet, okay, right? You only get dial-up internet, right? So like, I don't know if you guys remember how awful dial-up internet was. Like, oh man, I clicked the wrong link. Now I have to sit here and wait for this page to load, to then click back for it to load, to then click the right link for it to load. You know, like, just miserable. And then, so they get dial-up only, and then they only get old school printer that sounds like a machine gun. You know, you remember those? You know, kicks out the paper one line at a time. Like, I would have so much joy in my heart to see some of my students just yelling at a printer to go faster. Like, that would just make me so happy. Or for them to, like, actually have to pay attention to road signs instead of having something, like, guide them by hand. Like, hey, two miles, it's coming up. 1 mile, 900 feet. Hey, you got a turn now. Here's your turn. Like, come on. No, you need the old school days of where you're looking at this page and you're like, is this my exit? I don't know if this is my exit. Yep, this is my exit. Oh, man. Let me ask another question. Okay, so this is audience participation. Raise your hands if anyone still has physical maps in their car. Now, I'm not calling you old, but if you notice, there was few to none of my age or younger who raised their hands. Just throwing that out there. Oh man, I remember right back in the day, everybody, it didn't matter whose car you got in, there was a map tucked in somewhere, it was in the glove box, center console, in the pouch behind the passenger seat, there was a map somewhere, maybe multiple maps. You know, if you were like really into traveling, you had like the whole Atlas book of like all the states. So yeah, Jake, there you go, yeah. Man, there's so many things. My dad had a bag phone too, I won't get into that, but like, I feel like my kids would be like, what? but right now, like, everybody had these maps. And so, you know, it's just funny how things change like this. But maps are still so handy, right? Like, there's still dead zones where all of a sudden your phone's not getting reception. And that map might come in really handy. There might be times where your phone, like Apple phones, they're notorious for losing battery fast. You better hope you have a charger in your car because that phone dies. How do you know where you're getting? You better hope you have that map. And the simple purpose of a map is to know where I am, where I want to go, and what the road looks like from point A to point B. Right, that's the simple purpose of the map, to know where I am, where I am going, and what the road looks like from point A to point B. And what I find fascinating about this is if I pulled up a map of Iowa, right, it's going to be littered with cross-hatching lines of roads, tons and tons of roads that span the state. And at some point, right, at some point in history, none of those roads existed. None of those roads existed at some point. I'm sure there's some of you, let's do another raise of hands. How many people remember when I-29 wasn't here? Okay, yeah. it's crazy to think about, like, right, like I-29 is such a regular part of daily of our lives now, and at one point, right, it wasn't there. A map is most useful because somebody took the time to make sure that we could get from point A to point B. Someone took the time to build roads to make travel easier. And as we look at the four Gospels in the beginning of the New Testament, they examine the life of Christ, and I think it's fair to call Jesus a road builder. Right? He came to earth to help us get from here to the Father. That's what he came to do. Hey, let me help you get from here to the Father. We've talked about this passage before, but I want to read it again. It's from John 14. And this is what John talks about in John 14. He says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you will also may be where I am. You know the way to the place I am going." And Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" And Jesus answered, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." If we want to understand the road to get from here on earth to be with Jesus and the Father, then we need to look at Jesus because he made the way and he is the way. And this is why the Gospels are such important books, because they show us Jesus making the way possible for us through his example. And the Bible is our map that shows us the road that Jesus has created. And there are several things demonstrated through the life of Jesus that we are supposed to emulate. One of these is the act of baptism. And so let's look at our main passage for this morning. If you want, you can turn with me to the book of Matthew, chapter 3. Matthew, chapter 3. And as you turn there, let me give some context. So the cousin of Jesus, John the Baptist, had the task of preparing the way for the coming Messiah, for the Savior of God's people. And we know this, John knew this to be Jesus. And so he went around talking about the Messiah and getting people ready for the coming of Jesus by baptizing people into repentance. And something that can be confusing about all of this is that the baptism of Jesus is slightly different from John's typical baptism. And the baptism after the church started later is also slightly different from John's baptism and Jesus' baptism. And we have 8 weeks to talk about it, so we'll get it all nailed down. It's going to be great. But let me start reading in Matthew 3, verse 13. "Then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to be baptized by John. But John tried to deter him, saying, 'I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me?' And Jesus replied, 'Let it be so now. It is proper for us to do this to fulfill all righteousness.' Then John consented, and as soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water, and at that moment, heaven was opened. And he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him, and a voice from heaven said, 'This is my Son, whom I love, and with I am well pleased.'" There are several important things to note about this passage, and it's going to be one that we come back to several times in the series, but one of the reasons this moment is so important is because it's one of the few times in the Bible that we get to see the Father, the Son, and the Spirit all present together in a story. Now, this is not to say that they aren't present together in other moments where one or more isn't mentioned, but there's only a handful of times in the Bible where all three are mentioned like this. And it's worth noting, I think it lends the importance to this moment. All three play a role at this baptism. And the same can be said for our own baptisms, right? We are committing to the Father. We are capable of doing this. We are capable of committing to the Father because of the Son. and we are given the Holy Spirit to help along the way. But for this morning, what I want to focus in on with this story is, as I mentioned in the context of this passage, John was typically providing a baptism of repentance, right? Which is for sinners to realign themselves with God, right? That's a huge important part of what he is doing, for sinners to realign themselves with God. And this begs a huge question. Why is Jesus getting baptized? Why would Jesus get baptized? He has no need to repent. There is no sin in his life that he needs to turn from. So why is he doing this? And I think the answer comes at what the heart of repentance is. Right? No, Jesus has nothing he needs to turn from, but part of repentance is committing our ways to God's will. Right? The first part of repentance is, hey, there's these things that I need to turn from. And then it's, hey, from now on, I will commit myself to your perfect ways, God. I'm going to say, yes, my ways were terrible. I'm going to come to you and I'm going to focus on your ways, God. I'm going to focus on your will for my life. And so Jesus is not turning away from sin. He doesn't need to be baptized for sin in his life. Jesus is getting baptized to demonstrate the commitment that he has to the Father's will. That he's saying, Father, I am going to commit myself to making the decisions that you want me to make after this point. Right? Knowing how hard the road is going to be, your will is going to be the highest priority in my life. And what I find interesting also about this is, when does Jesus make this decision? Right, this is at the very beginning of his ministry. This is right before Jesus goes out to do all his miracles, his teachings, all the things that we spend most of the time reading the Gospels about are about to take place, but it starts here with the baptism of Jesus. And so from the very beginning, he is saying, hey, whatever comes ahead, my goal is to follow the will of God. And this matters because I think some people get confused with baptism being the last needed element of their salvation, right? I've got this checklist that I've got to do, and after I hit a certain point, I'm good. And a lot of times, it's that final act of baptism that people, you know, that's my last check mark. I'm good now. I've got my salvation. I don't have to worry about things. And that's not what we see from Scripture. It's not the end, but is the start of our walk with God. And we can know that part of this is Christ's commitment to the Father because of what comes right after this. Because if you look at Matthew chapter 4, you know where Jesus went immediately from this? To the wilderness. Right? He went from here to the wilderness for his commitment to the Father to be tested for 40 days. And so here's what I want us to understand after this first week of talking about baptism. As Christians, we go on this long journey from here on earth to someday in heaven. We have this road in front of us that we have to walk. And we have to come along it, and Jesus is going to show us the way. He's going to walk with us. I don't know, back in, you know, when I was growing up, we had a song, The Heavenly Road. Going to lay down my burden. I won't sing it. I'm a terrible singer. Right, but we are on this road to heaven. We are on this walk in our journey with God. And at the very beginning, what we need to understand and what we need in our life is this commitment to say, God's will is the biggest priority. God's will is the most important priority for this walk that I have in front of me. And what did Jesus show us that commitment to look like? The act of baptism. An act which we commit ourselves to God, an act where we say, I see there's a road in front of me. I don't know exactly what it's going to look like. I don't know exactly what this journey is going to entail, but my desire is to follow your will, God. And if you've already been baptized, how is that commitment going? Right? Because again, Jesus went from being baptized in the Jordan to walking around in the wilderness without food. In the tough times in your life, since you've been baptized, how has your commitment to the will of God been? Do you feel in those moments in your life, those hard moments where things get tough, that you have adequately asked yourself, what is God's will of me here at this point? Because while Jesus was in that wilderness, it wasn't about, like, I'm hungry, I don't want to be here, I wish Satan would stop attacking me. Right? Jesus' focus, his commitment, that whole time was concerned about the will of his Father. Hey, I'm hungry. Yeah, I could turn this bread into, or this bread into stone. Backwards. Stone into bread. But it's not about my desire. It's about what God's desire is of me. So when you find yourself in a hard situation, how high of a priority is the will of God for you in that moment? Because if you've been baptized, then you have made a commitment to God's will. That his will always be the highest priority. And it doesn't matter what else crops up. It doesn't matter what comes at us during this journey in life. Whatever this walk looks like from earth to heaven, the only thing that matters is, am I following God? And I also say this because for those of you who are on the fence about baptism, considering baptism, I want you to understand that commitment. That baptism means I'm putting aside my desires and I'm saying I want what God wants. I want to follow God's will. And for Jesus, he would follow God's will to the cross, the grave, and beyond. And so why does this commitment matter? Because it's how I know I'm on the right path. Right? It'd be silly, you know, you think back in the day before smartphones and all this stuff, right? You had a map in your car because it was, this is how I know where I am and where I know I am going. It'd be silly to toss it out the window and be like, man, it's fine. Like, no, we need that in our life. And so why does this commitment to God's will matter? Because it's how I know that I'm going in the right direction, that I'm heading where I need to be. I might not know what's coming next, but if I'm following God, I know I'm going to make it to my destination someday. And so as we wrap up this first week on baptism, understand that this is an act to come early in our walk with God, because it is us determining our priorities as we go about getting from earth to heaven. Will you pray with me? Dear God, I thank you for your Son and the example that he set, that yes, he would build a road from us from here on earth to heaven. And I'm so excited for these next 7 weeks now to continue to talk about this act of baptism and what that means for our life. And no, your Son did not have any sin to turn away from, but we know that he was in that moment committing himself to your will. That he was showing us what it looks like to commit ourselves to your will. And he would continue to demonstrate that as he went on and faced the wilderness, as he would face people that would jeer at him and try to tempt him and test him. And as he would walk that road to the cross, that each and every step he knew he was on the right path because he was following your will, God. And so I pray that for those of us who have been baptized, that we remember the commitment that we have made to following you, that yes, in hard times in life, it can get easy to sink back into what we want, to what we think is right. But help us understand that it's not just about that you are right, God. It's that if we choose your will, we know we will make it to our destination someday to be with you, no matter what the road getting there looks like. So help us find strength and encouragement to revive that commitment if needed, that yes, God, I am going to follow your will. It is going to be the highest priority in my life. I'm going to make a commitment to ask myself more often, what do you need of me here, God? Help me know that I am on the right path, going in the right direction. And for those here this morning who maybe have not been baptized yet or thinking about it or learning about it, I hope they know that yes, this is a big commitment, but this is how we get from point A to point B. By following the road that Jesus has created for us, the one that he is the example for, and that baptism is this wonderful step in the beginning of our journey with you, God. To help us get from earth to heaven. So yes, we thank you for your son, and it's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Good morning, Wyoming Christian Church. It's good to see you all this morning. It's good to have you guys here. I invite you to stand and sing with us this morning, but before we do, I just want to read one more scripture. You'll humor me. It's going to be from Romans chapter 6, verse 5. And we'll continue on for a few more verses, but it says, "For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. For we know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God." And so I just want to invite you, as we sing this morning, that if you're on the fence, that we want to invite you to come down and just have some fun in the water and just make a decision to take that first step with Jesus this morning. That the baptistry is always ready. It's never an inconvenience. It's, you know, we had people make decisions last week. We had six baptisms just last week alone. And that was an awesome opportunity to be a part of, and it was such an honor. And if you have any interest, just talk to Jed or myself or one of the elders, and we can make arrangements, and there's no day like today. So I invite you to stand with us this morning. We'll sing some songs.
Brothers, sisters, come on down to that river. Guaranteed you'll never be the same. There's a fountain flowing from the heart of the Savior. Bring your sins and all your guilty stains. Let that river of life wash it all away. You've been searching, carrying burdens. You've been lost and looking for a home. You've been drifting, something is missing. And you should know that you are not alone. Hey! Brothers, sisters, come on down to that river. Guaranteed you'll never be the same. There's a fountain flowing from the heart of a Savior. Bring your sins and all your guilty sins. Let that river of life wash it all away. Oh, come on down to the river. Oh, time to waste. Open your heart, don't be afraid. Jump on in, the water is fine. Sailing in the river of life. Come as you are, no time to waste. Open your heart, don't be afraid. Jump on in, the water is fine. Sailing in the river of life. Brothers, sisters, come on down to that river. Guaranteed you'll never be the same. To the river.
You guys sound great this morning. That's what I'm talking about.
That is excellent.
Let's continue to raise this party up this morning. Let's say hallelujah for the cross. Amen. Let's go.
I would be hopeless without your goodness. I would be desperate without your love. Slave to the darkness if it wasn't for the cross. You have won your kindness. You chased me down when I was lost. Where would I be if it wasn't for the cross? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I was a prisoner. Now I'm not, yeah. With your blood you bought my freedom. Hallelujah for the cross.
That's why we sing to you, God.
Now my shame was met with now your mercy will be my song. Know the glory, know the power of the cross. And hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I was a prisoner. Now I'm not, yeah. With your blood you bought my freedom. Hallelujah for the cross. By your stripes I'm healed, by your death I live. The power of sin is overcome. It is finished, it is done. By your stripes I'm healed, by your death. your blood, you bought my freedom. And hallelujah for the cross. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I was a prisoner. Now I'm not. With your blood, you bought my freedom.
All of our shames, all of our hurts, all of our iniquities were met with your mercy. And your mercy is our song forever. Lord, we're so thankful. Lord, with hearts of gratitude, we worship you this morning. We recognize that baptism is only the first step, Lord, of an eternal relationship with you. That we get to celebrate with you. We get to be in community with you. We get to celebrate the highs and get encouragement and comfort and security from the lows of this life, Lord, knowing that you have won the battle and that you have taken care of everything. Lord, I pray that you would meet us here in this time of communion and meditation this morning, moving forward. In your son's name, amen. You guys may be seated.
Good morning. What a church service. I was going to be honest with you, I was going to come up here and talk about some really serious stuff. And after all this, I don't know, we might have to change gears here a little bit. But anyhow, I think what Matt and Jed are talking about is a big theological term called sanctification. And if you really look at what Christianity is all about, it's a walk with God. We don't all start out at the same place. We don't start out at the same time. You know, for one person, it might be a long-term study, come about things through educational types of things. And to others, it's somewhat of a lightning bolt, a kind of epiphany that happens that all of a sudden you realize, hey, I got to do something about something. I don't know what, but I got to do it, and you get it done. So that's what sanctification is all about. That's what I was going to start out and talk about was worship. And I was going to start out and talk about that there's two kinds of words. One is entomology and one is etymology. The en means that you're studying insects. Anything with ology on the back side of it means a study of, okay? But etymology is a study of words. And so I thought this morning what I'd try to discuss at this time of communion would be, what is worship? Worship is the feeling or expression of reverence and adoration for God or a deity. That's what Webster says it is. It's to honor, adulate, revere, or venerate. It can be used as a noun, or it can be used as a verb, meaning an act of doing something. The extreme forms of worship would be love, which would be the noun part, or loving, which would be the verb part. True worship is when we love Him with all of our hearts, put Him first above all. Jesus said in the Gospels, love with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. I think sometimes we often confuse this with preaching or praise or getting together in the church building and meeting as a corporate body and doing what we're doing this morning. But it can also be a time when you're alone and you do it by yourself. So what is true worship? It's respectful devotion, loving, honoring, obeying God of the universe. acknowledge and celebrate his power and perfection and gratitude. Understand the awe of God's holiness. Remember how great he is. You know, a lot of times, I don't know about you guys, but sometimes when I'm sitting here in the communion thing, I'm thinking about cooking the food. I'm not thinking about cooking the food. Katie probably is. But I mean, you know, I'm thinking about things to do after the service, whatever else, and you're not really focusing on what God wants us to do. John MacArthur said that the highest form of worship is prayer, that which we're to do when we have communion. Communion is a meal that our Savior has prepared for us. He sacrificed himself for us, so we should do the same for him. In Romans 12:1, it says, and this is Paul writing to brethren, therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy, pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. What are the real signs of worship? A thankful life, sanctification, repentance, humility, obedient hearts, lover of God's word, passion for God's presence, faithfulness. We're to submit and surrender all of our cares to God. So as we turn this time to our communion service and what we think about God, put the things out of your mind about what's happening after the service or how the cooking's going at home or what you got to do next week, and turn to God. Psalms 46:10 says, be still and know that I am God. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning that we can come and worship, sing praises, preach, hear your word, and basically try to be rejuvenated. We ask that you would, at this time, help us contemplate on what you did for us and the sacrifice that you gave. We ask that you would help us in our sanctification and walk, that we would reconnoiter where we are and what we need to do to continue to be pleasing to you. We just thank you for all the many wonderful things you've done, and most of all for your son, Jesus. We pray these things in your son's name. Amen. Let's pray one more time. Dear God, we, as we continue in prayer this morning, we just ask that you would take these blessings that you've given us and that we might bring forth some treasures for you, that you might use them for your kingdom. We just ask that you would bless these gifts and offerings that we have, and most of all, the offering of our life. We just thank you for these things, and we ask that you would continue to guide and bless this church and Jed and Matt and all the people that work with it and all the people that are here. We just thank you for all you do. We pray these things in your Son's name. Amen.
It's been an absolute pleasure being able to worship with you guys as per usual each and every Sunday, and then just to celebrate with family, to celebrate with loved ones, both in biological blood and in spiritual blood of the Lamb. I invite you to stand with us this morning as we sing our final song this morning. It's called My Lighthouse. It's ending on a more energetic note. And as Dad talked about, whatever is loving the Lord, whatever is obeying Him in this moment is for you, whatever that worship looks like, whatever that praise looks like, you're not going to have judgment from anyone else here in this room. You're not going to have judgment anywhere else. If you want to dance, if you want to clap, you want to shout, you want to sing off key like Jed does every once in a while, just kidding, buddy. We just want to have fun. I mean, you're not going to get in trouble. You're not going to get lambasted or anything like that. We just want to celebrate with y'all. And so we invite you to stand with us this morning and sing My Lighthouse.
In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. Questions your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, shining through the darkness. I will follow you. Whoa, the promise, you will carry me safe to shore. The peace in my troubled sea. brightest. You will lead us through the storms.
Hey!
Far before us, you're the brightest. You will lead us through the storms.
Hey!
Far before us, you're the brightest. You will lead us through the storms.
Hey!
In my lighthouse, shining through the darkness, I will follow you. Promise you will carry me safe to shore. Safe to shore. Safe to shore. Safe to shore.
We'll see you guys in 1 week. Have a great rest of your week. We'll see you soon. Take care.